Ladies and gentlemen, I think we are going to start. I hope that people will enter the room, and if you can help us to ask them to come. I am pleased to introduce Mr. Le Gall, who is definitely the great figure in Europe of space activities, and it has been so. It has held the most important positions for decades now. And he will make a presentation on space as a major technological and governance adventure. And he will stress fundamentally, I think, three dimensions of space activities. The first one is innovation. Space is a huge source of technological innovation. That's obvious, but it has to be clarified. The second dimension, which is perhaps less well known, is the importance, the crucial importance of space activities for climate change and climate policy, and more generally, the human dimension of the future of planet Earth. And last but not least, the future, great future adventure of the conquest of planet Mars, which is certainly the great dream, perhaps reality, for the next quarter of a century or so. So, Jean-Yves, I think we should start now, and I give you the floor.
So, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor for me to speak in front of you this afternoon and to speak about space. And as a matter of fact, this meeting happens just after what I used to call the Golden Week that we had in France and in Europe for space. Since last week, we had four major events. First, during the COP22 in Marrakech, very important decisions about space and climate have been taken by space agencies, and I will come back to them. In Europe, we decided to go ahead with the next generation of launchers, so-called Ariane 6. We had the last first day in the morning the launch of four satellites of the European Galileo Global Navigation Satellite System from Kourou in French Guiana with an Ariane 5 launch vehicle. And the afternoon, you probably saw that we had the launch from Baikonur in Kazakhstan of the French astronaut Thomas Pesquet. And Thomas Pesquet is now in the International Space Station when he will stay 6 months. So it means that he will be back by mid of May. And so it seems that with these small events, we can consider that space is everywhere we look. And in fact, you probably know that space exploration started out as a conquest to walk on the moon in the 60s, to discover new stars, to study the formation of galaxies, analyze the composition of planets, and seek out the origin of life. For it is in our nature to keep pushing the limits of what we know and where we go. This urge to explore has led to human spaceflight and launching satellites and probes into space for science, Earth observation, telecommunications, and defense. In this picture, you have the launch by Europe's Ariane 5 launch vehicle in August 2013 of Qatar's first telecommunication satellite. And we have been very honored to launch this first Qatari satellite. And over nearly 60 years, thousands of satellites have enabled humankind, after conquering the land, sea and air, to conquer a fourth element, space. In particular, we have launched a host of robotic probes into our solar system and beyond to gain new insights into the world we live in. We have explored the moon, as you know, all the planets of the solar system out to Pluto, and even some of their moons. Saturn's moon Titan, for example, has been visited by the Huygens probe a few years ago. And over the last 2 years, the world has held its breath as the Rosetta Orbiter and Philae Lander got close to the nucleus of comet Churyumov-Gerasimenko. You see on this picture the nucleus of the comet. And when we launched Rosetta in 2004, we thought that the nucleus of a comet was a big ball of dirty snow. And when you see what you see, it is clear that we discovered many things, that when Rosetta went close to the comet, we started to think that there was something wrong in the optics, because when we saw this very strange nucleus, we thought that there was something wrong, but this is a reality. And this success of an unprecedented mission, the first to land a man-made object on a comet, is also down to Europe and its space agency, the European Space Agency, working with the German Space Agency, DLR, and CNES, the French Space Agency. Now, if we have a look closer to home, Earth-orbiting satellites have produced a more complete picture of the global environment and are helping us today to study it more easily. You see on this picture a view of Doha. You can see the Sheraton Hotel, which is not so far from the top of the picture. And this is typically the kind of pictures which are taken by satellites. But the satellites allow also forecasts, which allow to predict the weather. Satellites are also helping to protect populations from environmental threats, detecting natural and man-made disasters, and probing soils, oceans, and vegetation for the benefit of all. And of course, satellites are crucial instruments supporting efforts to curb climate change. It is the French-US TOPEX Poseidon and JASON 1, 2, and 3 satellites that have revealed rising global temperatures and sea levels, and which tomorrow will ensure that international accords like the Paris Agreement, which had been taken last year at the end of the COP21, that these agreements are effectively implemented. Now, a few words about telecommunications. As well as satisfying our thirst for knowledge, discoveries, and new frontiers, space is also serving very concrete applications in our everyday lives. All around the world, even in its remotest regions, satellites are delivering television, internet access, and fixed and mobile telephony services. They are also the go-to means of transmission for broadcasting major world events. Satellites are also enabling pedestrians, hikers, motorists, and pilots to locate their position with metric accuracy, choose between possible routes, and find their friends wherever they are. In this domain, too, European industry has achieved a world-class status thanks to programs funded by governments, and with the launch of last week, we have now a total of 18 Galileo satellites in orbit, and this will allow us to announce, probably by mid of December, the new services allowed by Galileo, which will be a new system close to the GPS. Last but not least, of course, defense. And I put on this picture a view of the Rafale, which has been chosen by both the French and the Qatar Air Force. And finally, satellites are protecting citizens' health and safety, providing precise information and services, like, for example, to locate distress calls and guide the search and rescue teams. Satellites are also playing a vital role, helping to prevent and manage conflicts by providing high-resolution optical and radar imagery, secure telecommunications and signals intelligence. Today, most of weapons which are on the battlefield use satellites to exchange data between them, and this will continue to develop, and it will be more and more useful in the future. Now I would like to say a few words about our environment, because I spoke about launchers, science, Earth observation, telecommunications, defense. But what we see is that in this context of what I can say burgeoning space applications, we have a new world order which is taking shape with the United States, which is the indisputable and uncontested leader, Europe, Japan and Russia holding their own, and the rise of China and India. But an increasing number of emerging space powers are lining up behind these legacy players. Some rich, like Qatar, of course, the United Arab Emirates, Azerbaijan, and a few others with the resources to build large, expensive satellites, and some less so. We are moving into space with smaller and cheaper satellites. All of these players have grasped that developing their own space program or even space industry will enable them to play with the big boys in the international arena while reaping significant rewards in terms of public policy making. And now, in total, we have roughly more than 60 countries which develop their own space program, and this is going to continue. The countries which already have a space program are going to have a bigger space program, and newcomers are going to arrive because the space is more and more attractive, and it is also more and more useful. Alongside these efforts, which are roughly and mostly sponsored by nation states, a new movement has emerged from the US and taken hold around the globe. This movement, called New Space, is being shaped by rich and ambitious entrepreneurs eager to transform this business. While Bridgestone's Sir Richard Branson was the first to set his sights on the stars, and Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon, have now followed in his first steps. However, they are only figureheads, for in their wake are hundreds of firms who, although they may have fewer resources, are equally ambitious. For instance, a new space imaging company has launched no fewer than 110 satellites in the last 5 years. 110 satellites, it means that during the last 5 years, this new company launched more satellites than all the satellites which had been launched for Earth observation in all the years before. And so they launched 110 satellites with the aim of doing more with less money. And the launch industry is no exception, with a number of projects in the US and the rest of the world. And that is why Europe responded as early as 2014, 2 years ago, with an historic decision to develop Ariane 6, and Ariane 6 will be really a new launcher because the objective is to divide by two, which is really, really impressive, to divide by two the cost of access to space, so it means the cost of to launch a satellite. For instance, today, when you launch a satellite of telecommunications, the cost of the launch is $20,000 per kilo. And in the future, with Ariane 6, it will be $10,000 per kilo. But obviously, it is very, very difficult to reach this objective. And this is why, in fact, we have in front of us three defining challenges. And the first one is innovation. Innovation seeks to make a space a means rather than an end. GAFA, so Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon, are not focusing their ambitions on space as such, but rather on space as a means for connecting, observing, and a host of things yet to be imagined. Innovation is built on the foundation of space technologies and disruptive thinking. But you can't build a technological foundation without a significant research effort. And indeed, the key to the success of the new US launchers is a low-cost engine that is a result of more than 10 years of research at NASA, while the new satellite imaging companies are leveraging developments accomplished by others in microsatellites and nanosatellites. Now, this foundation has been led. Disruptive innovations such as projects to orbit constellations of several hundred or even several thousand satellites are taking hold. Google made an announcement 2 days ago of a project with 4,200 satellites. It will take time. Perhaps we will not have 4,000 satellites, but just 400, but it will be a huge move forward. And all these satellites, they are supposed to be developed, manufactured, and launched at for an extremely low cost. The challenge now for the public sector is to prepare tomorrow's technologies and to nurture and then support these disruptive innovations. The second challenge we have in front of us is climate. It is satellites that have provided the evidence of climate change. Without satellites, it would have been impossible to demonstrate that sea level is rising 3.2 millimeters a year. Likewise, it is satellites that would enable us to gauge nations' efforts to cut greenhouse gas emissions. We coordinated international monitoring efforts that led to two declarations, one from Mexico and the other one in New Delhi, that we adopted a few months ago. And we pushed for the use of space to monitor climate because out of the 50 essential climate variables which describe the climate, 26, more than half, can be only observed from space. And so, you see that for the prediction and the monitoring of climate change, satellites are key. The third challenge that we have in front of us, and it's a kind of, let us say, joke 2 days after the launch of Thomas Pesquet, this challenge concerns exploration. Because the current revolution in the space sector is set to have the unexpected effect of stepping up the pace of Mars exploration. Only 6 months ago, Mars exploration by humans was slated for 2040, 2050. It means in 25 years from now, so it's the infinite. But now, the launch of the first crewed mission to Mars is seemingly getting closer by the day, with some proposal now talking about 2030 or even 2025. Why? Because we are starting to see the benefits of the spectacular cost reductions in satellites and space launches, so that what was previously just a concept to send a spacecraft to Mars big enough to support a 4 to 6 person crew in space for 2 years, because going to Mars will take 2 years, 9 months to go from the Earth to Mars, 6 months in orbit waiting for a new launch window to come back, and 9 months to come back. Of course, the major issue is to be sure that the astronauts will stay in very good condition, and this is why we have now astronauts in the space station to learn or to live in space and to prepare for such a long mission. But many companies, many agencies are working now on this mission. And at the 67th International Astronautical Congress in Guadalajara, in Mexico, last September, crewed missions to Mars were everywhere to be seen, presented as a new space odyssey of modern times. Europe, meanwhile, is pursuing two particularly ambitious missions, automatic this time, so-called ExoMars. The first recently injected a satellite into Martian orbit, so-called the Thales Gas Orbiter, to detect some elements of the former atmosphere of Mars. And we will study the planet's atmosphere and evolution. And in 2020, in 4 years from now, a second mission will land a platform and rover carrying several scientific instruments on the planet's surface to collect and analyze samples that have not been exposed to the radiation oxidizers that would otherwise destroy organic materials. So, I would like to say that space is changing at a dramatic pace. We have seen many changes in recent years, but they constitute the most spectacular shift since the start of the space era. And in this very fast-moving environment, all players have responded through a vigorous and targeted innovation policy by taking up the climate challenge and by setting a crewed mission to Mars as a new frontier. For while innovating is vital, inspiration is just as crucial. The world's young generation needs to grasp the importance of science and technology and be motivated to embrace a career in this field, which is the only one capable of creating value and sustainable employment for nations. That is why our future programs will take us ever further and no doubt to Mars. We should also remember that from an economic and a social standpoint, €1 invested in commercial space generates up to €20 in economic spin-offs. Spending on space, therefore, makes economic sense to keep advancing science, new technologies, and environmental protection, as well as being a key element in ensuring access to today's multimedia world. That is why in Europe, France and its partners are pursuing an ambitious space policy funded in innovation and exploration. Indeed, France has the second largest per capita space budget in the world, just after the US. Many services that we now consider irreplaceable rely on satellite-driven applications, even though we don't always realize it. In a nutshell, you understood that space is definitely a major technological and governance adventure. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Jean-Yves. We have about 8 minutes. I would like to put you two questions because we like to dream a little bit. So my questions are about Mars, human missions in Mars. Well, the first one is short term. You reminded that it would be a 2 years rotation. And you say that the human factor is probably the most challenging one, because how to send people and have them not only alive, but also in good shape when they come back after 2 years. So my first question is, are we reasonably sure that this is feasible in a matter of 25 years? I have one or two medical doctors in the room, including my old friend Jean-Pierre Lablanchy, là-bas au fond. And I think that question, you know, the feasibility, the human feasibility of such a mission is a key question. So my second question would be very long term. So we jump one century from now. In one century, is it conceivable that the conquest of Mars could make it habitable again? Because everyone can have read a number of papers talking about recreating an atmosphere of Mars and this kind of the or conditions at least where we could have real human colonies in Mars who could live. And by the way, to do what? And what would be the benefits of such an adventure? So these are my two short questions.
Okay, thank you. On the first question, in fact, we are now gaining more and more experience having human in space. During the International Space Station, where the French astronaut Thomas Pesquet has arrived the day before yesterday, he will spend 6 months in the station. And I can tell you that after 6 months or 1 year, I was yesterday with a US astronaut, Scott Kelly, which spent 1 year in the station, he's in a very good condition. But this is not, as a matter of fact, it's because we have a lot of protocols which allow to prepare for such a mission. Astronauts are making a lot of sports and so on and so on. And after 1 year, it's okay. And the idea is, the day that when we will send 4 or 6 astronauts to Mars, it's a total mission of 2 years, to have a kind of small space station. The plan today is, whereas the space station, the International Space Station, which is orbiting at 300 kilometers over our heads, is 400 tons, to send a mini station of 70 tons to Mars with 2 key features. First, a kind of place where to have fresh vegetable, and it is possible to have this vegetable which will be produced permanently because astronauts need to have fresh food. And the second, a kind of small cylinder to create a kind of microgravity to allow the astronauts to spend 2 years in a space station. And we are in 2016, having such a mission in 2025, 2030. People in NASA think that it is feasible, and I think that it should be feasible, because what makes the difference is the size of the spacecraft you will send to Mars. In other words, the bigger is the spacecraft, the easier is the mission. And today, with the decrease of the cost of launching and producing spacecraft, it's probably possible. So this is the first question. The second question about what we can do in 100 years, I do agree in a number of books of science fiction is there is the idea to create a new atmosphere on Mars and so on, but I think that it is very, very long-term science fiction. In my opinion, of course, 100 years, it's completely out of thinking, because 50 years ago, we were just at the beginning of the space era, and nobody could have thought that we will speak now about going to Mars. And so in 100 years, I have no idea. But changing the atmosphere of a planet, it seems to me very, very difficult, even if today the human activity is modifying the atmosphere of our planet Earth, and this is why we have a climate change.
So I take 3 questions of people who have not spoken yet. Okay, Mr. Minister Yankovic, Monseigneur Sanchez Orondo, Michel Fouché. Peter, yeah.
Mike.
Et Laurence Nardon. But very short question, please, because we are running behind schedule very, very severely.
Thank you. The wonderful world that Mr. Jean-Yves Legallès described, this rapid change of technology and science, has of course one serious shortcoming. There has been no similar development of an international regulatory framework to canalize and to protect all the progress that we made in outer space. The Outer Space Treaty of 1967 will be now 50 years old. It has never been adapted to present condition. It talks about the time when there was only the Soviet Union and the United States in space. There's no talk about the role of space actors. And the most serious shortcomings concern 3 fields. First, there's no regulation of militarization of space, except the prohibition of weapons of mass destruction. We'll have an enormous problem of space traffic management. More and more satellites are now going into space. There's no such thing as space traffic management. And there's an even graver problem, talking about climate change. There's also a pollution problem in space debris, and has so far virtually no international regulation of that. So I think there are threats over this wonderful world that we have just received. And I think the international community still has a lot to do to correct these shortcomings.
Thank you, Peter. Monseigneur Sanchez Orlando.
I compliment for the very nice speech. My question is some relation with them. But what is the criteria? There are rules to determine the property of the space, because just is not the land. And what are the, you have some idea that what could be the solution of this very important problem? Thank you.
No.
Globalement. Michel Boucher.
Une question liée à mon ignorance, j'espère que vous la pardonnerez. Est-ce qu'on ne peut pas imaginer une première mission sur Mars avec des robots plutôt que des hommes, à moins que l'aventure soit aussi humaine que technologique?
L'aventure est humaine, évidemment. Laurence, Short et M. Narayanan. On n'entend pas.
Merci.
On entend trop.
Oui. Juste pour savoir si dans ce projet martien que vous nous décrivez, on connaît bien les coopérations anciennes du CNES avec les autres pays européens et avec les États-Unis, y a-t-il d'autres pays impliqués comme l'Inde, la Chine, d'autres partenaires habituels du CNES? Merci.
Monsieur Narayanan. Et c'est fini après. La technologie trop pointue.
Now I must congratulate you on a very, very illuminating talk. But in my previous capacity as a national security advisor, I had a lot to do with the Indian space program. Is it possible to give us an idea about the collaboration that's taking place between different space agencies in the exploration of space? I know we have our Mars mission, and I know that particularly between ISRO and CNES, there's been a lot of association. But is it possible to give us a little bigger picture of what's going on? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. So very quickly, on the regulation of space, of course, there are some pieces of regulation which are existing. But we are continuing to adapt permanently these regulations according to the technological development. And this is why it's so important to discuss about space in front of such a distinguished audience, because I think that it's important to exchange ideas. This is the first point. The second question was about robots on Mars. We have already robots on Mars, and we have many robots on Mars sent by mostly by the US, because it's not so easy to land on Mars. But we have rovers, and we have French instruments on this rover. And the idea is to send human people, because human can do things that robots cannot think. For instance, on the moon, the last Apollo mission, Apollo 17, has been probably the most fruitful, because there was the commander of the lunar module was a geologist, Eugene Cernan, and he took exactly the right rocks that he had to take, and all his colleagues did differently. About the Mars mission and the cooperation, it is clear that the keywords for space are three, in my opinion: innovation, inspiration because we need young people and to have a real space program, you need to have excellent engineers because it's really on the edge of the technology. And so we need excellent engineers. So the second keyword is inspiration. But the third keyword, probably the most important, is cooperation. And today we have the International Space Station, which gathers all the space powers of the planet, except China and India. We have numerous cooperation with India and China, and I am sure that the mission to Mars will be probably the ultimate mission, and we will have to associate all the space powers of the International Space Station, plus very certainly China and India.
Quand on commence à parler de l'espace, on a envie de continuer parce que, encore une fois, cela fait rêver. But I think there is no doubt that space activities and human space activities will play a major role in the next decades, if only because humanity needs adventure. And that's probably one of the most exciting sources of adventure and also of technological progress with sometimes totally unforeseeable applications. For instance, even for people like me or people who were studying general relativity, for instance, 3 or 4 decades ago, when we were taught fields like that, we could not have the slightest idea that even general relativity would have concrete implications. It was thought to be only a theory to understand cosmology and this sort of subject. Today, GPS would not work without general relativity behind. So, l'aventure n'est pas terminée. Thank you very much, Jean-Yves.
Il y a quand même quelqu'un qui va être utile.